Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Quoth the Drow Nevermore by Martha Carr and Michael Anderle. Narrated by Devon Sorvari. Chapter 1. Sitting in a cheap metal folding chair on his side of the iron bars, L'zar Verdys studied his halfling daughter with a feral grin.
I suppose I owe it to you to give you the first shot at this. So, is there anything you want to ask me?
Yeah. Why'd you just leave her that night without a word? Cheyenne's anger burned even stronger inside her, racing up her spine and across her shoulders, fueling her. But she was already in her drow form. The purple-gray skin and bone-white hair, pointed ears and glowing golden eyes, just like her father's. So there really was nothing to hold back. L'zar let out a soft, low chuckle, like a rumbling purr.
Going right for the throat, I see.
Don't tell me you expected a bunch of polite small talk.
Honestly, I didn't expect much of anything.
L'zar stretched his legs out in front of him, crossing one ankle over the other in his gray, prison-issue sweatpants, and scratched the side of his chin.
So far, I've been nothing but pleasantly surprised.
Are you going to answer my question or not? Cheyenne studied the drow prisoner's calculating gaze, the secret smile on his dark lips.
He looks real cozy behind those bars, like he doesn't care where he is.
There's a short and long answer for everything, he said.
Right now, all you need to know is I left the way I did because I had to.
Bullshit.
L'zar shrugged. You can believe whatever you want, but you're getting your answers from the source now. I left without a word because I couldn't let your mother know who I really am. I also couldn't run the risk of you knowing until you were ready to find me, which, apparently, you now are.
Cheyenne shook her head. You escaped from Chateau D'rahl that night on your own. Why'd you come back to turn yourself in?
Because I had to, and so you could come find me when you were ready.
Are those gonna be your answers for everything? L'zar cocked his head.
Only for the questions you're asking right now. Anything else?
He doesn't want to tell me anything. The halfling pressed her lips together and glared at the drow who'd given her all her power and left her to figure it out on her own.
Well, while you think about it, I'll just keep the ball rolling.
He tossed the loose strands of white hair out of his eyes.
How's school?
She blinked.
It's a joke. That doesn't surprise me. I imagine there's very little your professors can teach you at this point, after everything you've managed on your own. The dark web feels like a remarkably fitting place for a dark elf to spend her time, even a halfling.
How the hell does he know about that? Cheyenne shifted in the chair. As the guy who knocked up Bianca Summerlin and abandoned her, and me, you seem to think you actually know who I am.
I'm sure there's much more beneath the surface.
L'zar chuckled again, his golden eyes flashing in the dim yellow lights bolted to the stone walls of the dungeon.
I really am anxious to dig deeper. I know there's plenty you don't show the rest of the world.
You don't know anything about me. Whatever drow spy trick you're trying to pull, I'm not buying it.
I'm not asking you to buy into anything, Cheyenne.
He rocked back in his chair, like he was buckling down to get really comfortable.
Tell me about your friend in the hospital.
What?
The one born Earthside, who can't use what was passed down to her by blood. I hope she's recovering well.
He won't flat out say what Ember is when Sir and the guard are listening. What kind of bullshit game is that? That's none of your business, she muttered. And I didn't come here to talk about someone else.
No, of course not.
L'zar licked his lips, and the next smile he gave her almost looked gentle.
You came here to see your drow father with your own eyes, to size up the man who made you what you are, just to know if he fits into the same shape your imagination gave him. Well, were you close?
Her nostrils flared as he spread his arms and chuckled again. This is just a game to him. Don't you have any questions about her? L'zar shook his head.
Not really. You're far more interesting, Cheyenne, and you wouldn't tell me anything about your mother even if I wanted to know. Let's cut the bullshit, huh? You and I are the same that way. We don't do very well with pretenses.
Cheyenne scoffed. Fine. Why did you leave her the box?
For you. Don't ask questions you already know the answer to. It's boring, and it's not who you are.
Then tell me what it's for. How does it work? L'zar shook his head.
That's for you to discover on your own, and I am so looking forward to the day when you reach that point. I hope you'll come and tell me all about it.
A new flash of rage churned through her. He has to give me something. Okay, since you think you know so much about my life and what I'm getting into, tell me about the bull's head. For the first time, L'zar reacted to her words with something other than blasé amusement. His eyes widened, and he pulled his legs in toward the chair again before leaning forward.
What about it? Can't give too much away with our fro audience in the booth.
I've been seeing it around a lot lately, on magicals who think they know something about me, too.
What does it mean?
The drow on the other side of the bars sucked his teeth and hissed.
That's an issue that should have stayed in Umbaro Ghoul, where it belongs.
Yeah, well, it didn't. And now it's my issue. Cheyenne leaned toward his face, so much like her own. Now's your chance to make this little meeting worth my time. What does it mean?
He shook his head. We're not gonna talk about that.
Then I've run out of things to say. Easter Bunny! A high-pitched whine filled the dungeon a second before those iron bars lit up with crackling green fell energy, buzzing and sparking between father and daughter. The low lights inset into the walls flashed from a dull yellow to an eerie red, and a blaring alarm cut through the cavern every 5 seconds. L'zar glanced quickly at the ceiling, and the fell energy crackling down the iron bars of his visitation cage. In one swift movement, he stood from the chair and stepped away from the bars. His white teeth glinted in the red alarm lights when he grinned at her and offered her one slow nod. Cheyenne stood from her chair and meant to push it aside. Instead, the thing went flying sideways across the cavern and clattered against the stone wall. Swift, urgent footsteps echoed behind her, then a warning arm settled on her elbow.
Let's go, the guard said over the alarm.
The halfling jerked her elbow away and glared at L'zar. The drow prisoner threw his head back and laughed, the sound ringing out across the dungeon between the blaring bursts of the alarm splitting Cheyenne's head.
Come see me again when you've learned how to ask the questions that really matter, he said through his laughter. Then these little talks will be a lot easier for both of us.
Forcing herself not to fling her magic at those bars and tear the whole cell apart to get to him, Cheyenne spun on her heels and stormed back toward the booth. Sir stood just beside the open door, his arms folded, his face showing no expression. L'zar's laughter followed her toward the booth, and she didn't bother turning around to see what would happen to him next.
Should have known the real L'zar would be a lot more disappointing than I imagined.
She didn't look at Sir as she stepped into the booth stretching across the cavern. He entered behind her with the prison guard close on their heels, then the door shut with a loud click and a metallic echo. The guard slammed his hand down on the control panel, and the obnoxiously screaming alarm cut out entirely, at least inside the booth. The red lights still illuminated the dungeon and L'zar's overlarge cell, and the fell energy still fizzled along those thick iron bars, creating a muddy halo of green and red light around them.
"That was a lot shorter than I expected," Sir muttered.
"Why are you complaining?" Cheyenne spat. "Now you have plenty of time to make it back for lunch." Sir didn't find that very funny and folded his arms again as she pushed the door on the other side of the booth. She glanced back at the guard and spread her arms. "You gonna open this thing or what?" The man raised his eyebrows and pressed another button on the control panel. When the door buzzed, Cheyenne shoved her hands against it and stormed out the other side of the booth. The alarm was probably supposed to be silent now, but her drow hearing picked it up from the other side of the booth just the same. And L'zar's laughter continued. The elevator doors were closed when she reached them. Where's the damn button? She searched the stone walls, but couldn't find anything to call the stupid elevator back down.
"It's on its way," Sir said from behind her.
"Whatever." Cheyenne clenched her fists by her sides and stared at the closed doors set into the stone wall. "And I woke up early for this." Chapter 2. As soon as Cheyenne and Sir stepped into the elevator, the blaring alarm cut out entirely. The lights inset in the walls stayed red, though, and the bars still hummed with green fell energy. L'zar smoothed his white hair away from his face and pulled a deep breath in through his nose. Another chuckle escaped him.
"That went well."
Waiting for the prison guards to make their way down here with their magical cattle prods and their dampening cuffs and all the fell-powered firearms they could hold, the drow moved back toward the back of the cell and lowered himself to the floor. He faced the back wall, crossing his legs beneath him, and centered his focus again.
"Just to be sure, a little double-checking never hurt anyone."
Hidden from the dungeon's security cameras and the guard in that damn booth, his hands moved in one more complicated pattern, drawing the power toward him for his next little spell. It was not to fight what was coming for him, or make things harder for the guards, although the thought was tempting. Right now, the distant past would give him more reassurance than anything. When he finished casting the spell, a wavering silver light bloomed in his hands and illuminated the stone wall of the cell in front of him. The shimmering, opalescent forms took shape quickly, and L'zar watched the conjured image of himself from so many centuries ago. There he sat in the Oracle's lair in Umbaro Ghul, the dark walls much lighter in his memory. There was a lot less blood on those walls, too, but the surroundings weren't important, just the conversation. The wizened, shriveled oracle, with black lines all over her wrinkled face, opened her eyes. They'd been a dark storm gray before he'd asked her for the prophecy of his lineage. Now they were a swirling, misty white.
"The Kuan is doomed to lose his bloodline time and again."
The voice was a raspy croak, rattling like death from an ancient mouth perpetually stained red.
"The endless search for an heir will bring each one of them to death's door. Only the Scion, never pursued, will rise to their destiny. When the shackles of the old laws crumble, their purpose will be fulfilled."
In this vision of L'zar's memory, he heard his own voice, so steady, so sure of itself, so goddamn foolish.
"Explain this, Oracle."
The prophetic whiteness filtered away from the oracle's eyes, and a wrinkled, gnarled hand reached into a bowl of blood sitting beside her. Fingers dipped into all that red, and she drew a line of it down her face, from forehead to beneath her chin.
"Every child you sire is doomed to the same fate, Kuan. You will go to them to mold each one into the shape of your heir, but you will fail. Death rides on the heels of your eagerness. Every child will fall beneath your guiding hand, and you will pursue them over and over to the same end.
The L'zar from centuries ago, wavering in the silver light of the memory spell, folded his arms and lifted his chin.
Will any of them survive?
No, not while you try so hard to bring them to their destiny. And you will keep trying, Drow. You will never stop.
The crone snickered and pressed a blood-covered finger against Lazar's chest.
Your greed and your pride make you unstoppable.
Then she bent over her aged lap and fell into a fit of wheezing, paper-thin cackles. Sitting in the cell in the dungeon, L'zar swiped his hand through the glistening light of his memory, and the vision disappeared. His knuckles cracked as he clenched his fists.
I was such a cocksure idiot then. That prophecy proved itself all right. Not this time. This time, my pride sits behind bars with me. We'll wait together for as long as it takes.
Chapter 3. Sir didn't ask Cheyenne to put the stupid black bag over her head again when they got back into his orange Kia Rio. Maybe he'd forgotten the route to Chateau D'rahl was supposed to be a secret. Maybe he knew if he told her to put it on, she'd send a blast of drow magic into his stupid mustache. Cheyenne didn't care what he thought, and she wasn't paying attention to the roads he drove them down anyway. L'zar can laugh all he wants. He's the one spending the rest of his life in a damn cage. After 10 minutes of strained silence, Sir cleared his throat.
I'm guessing that didn't go the way you were hoping.
No shit.
The guy's been nothing but a pain in the ass since we put him behind bars.
Sir shrugged and gripped the steering wheel with both hands.
Don't take it personally, halfling. It's not just you.
She had nothing to say.
Hey, at least he didn't try to throw you around the giant cavern or anything, or try to phase you through the bars to hold you hostage. He's a real piece of shit. You can count yourself lucky.
We're not having a heart-to-heart right now, Cheyenne muttered. Just stick to being an asshole. You're a lot better at that. A choking sound came from Sir's mouth. He might have tried to hold back a laugh. Instead, he readjusted his aviator sunglasses and cleared his throat again.
Yeah, I know.
Trees and cars and highway signs whizzed past them as he took her back toward the business park where she'd left her car. Cheyenne ran a hand through her hair and rolled her eyes. So, what has to happen before I get another escort to Chateau D'rahl?
Sir did a double take. You want to see him again?
Probably not. Just give me my options.
All right, halfling. I'd say our deal's still on the table if you're willing to keep sitting at it. You keep the phone on you and your schedule open. Stay chummy with Reinhardt for whatever ops we think could benefit from you sticking around. That will earn you more points to turn in for another fun get-together with Daddy.
Cheyenne snorted. Didn't think we were working on a point system.
Like a goddamn arcade, right? You win the tickets, you get a prize.
He shook his head.
We'll say 3 ride-alongs with my men equals 1 ride on the Chateau D'rahl Express. The thought of going back there to see the drow's ugly mug and listen to you two talk over each other doesn't make me jump for joy. But I'll take you again after the 3 more jobs.
Don't call it a job if you're not paying me anything. She turned her head just enough to shoot him a sideways glance. I thought Bianca drilled that into you hard enough. Sir grunted, but ignored the jibe about how quickly and easily her mom had buried him in legalities on the back veranda of her estate.
I'm paying you in visitations, halfling. You can't buy your way into Chateau D'rahl. Plenty of people have tried.
Plenty of magicals break out of there, too. Or was that just an extra special night for everyone? The morning sunlight glinted across Sir's face as it passed like a strobe light through the trees lining the highway. She caught a glimpse of his eyes darting toward her beneath the dark sunglasses before returning to the road.
That was a first. I'm not surprised it hasn't happened again.
Good to know you have so much faith in your security over there. The halfling thumped her head back against the headrest.
Those men know what they're doing, and the prison's security has gone through more updates than the iPhone I don't have. I'll tell you what, though. If the bastard really wanted out right now, he'd be out. He already did it once.
She didn't say anything to that. Sir had heard her entire conversation with L'zar, and already knew the answer the drow inmate had given for that one.
I want to know why he's still playing prisoner, Sir continued. Find out for me the next time you cash in your fro points for another visit, and you'll have unrestricted access to the guy. Then I can quit spending my Sundays being a goddamn halfling chauffeur.
Cheyenne turned to look at him full on. He's serious. Game on. Sir nodded and gave another little grunt.
Smart move, halfling.
Hey, while we're stuck in your car together, anything you can tell me about those bull's head pendants? The man's head rocked back in confusion, and he shot her a quick glance. Whatever she might have been able to see in his eyes was hidden by the tinted lenses.
I don't have a goddamn clue what you're spouting off about. Didn't even understand half the shit you two were talking about in there. If you want answers to useless questions, don't ask the guy who doesn't do useless.
Right, like Sir's been useful for much of anything. Didn't expect you to have an answer.
Oh, sure. Just want to keep up the small talk, huh? You suck at that. Just like I suck at emotions.
Cheyenne took a deep breath. He sounds a lot more desperate the longer I'm with him. She glanced at the sign for the next exit coming up, just two more before they'd turn off into the business park. Time to shut down drow mode. Think of the woods. The heat of her drow magic fizzled out in a second, drawing itself back inside her to wait for the next time she needed it. Her purple-gray skin faded back to its unnatural human paleness, the bone-white hair returning to high-voltage raven black. She lifted a hand absently to her ears to feel their rounded tops and dropped her forearm back onto the armrest. I can't wait to get out of this car. When Sir turned into the huge, empty parking lot, the buckle of Cheyenne's seatbelt clicked against the side of the car before they'd come to a complete stop. She jerked open the passenger side door as Sir shifted into park, and he snorted as she leaped out.
You and me both, halfling. Keep the phone.
The door slammed shut, and Cheyenne walked briskly to the driver's side of her matte gray Ford Focus with its chipped and peeling paint.
Yeah, I know. It's still on me.
Sir sped away in his screaming orange Kia Rio, and the halfling slipped quickly behind the wheel of her car. She took a deep breath to calm herself even further. As soon as she started the car, her personal phone let out a little chirp from inside her jacket pocket. Another text from Ember. Hey, if you're awake and not too busy, can you run by my place and pick up more of my things? Since it looks like I'll be staying here a little longer after all. Cheyenne smirked and texted back. No problem. What do you need? Clothes? Don't forget the underwear this time. Bathroom stuff? It's all pretty much in a bag on the counter. A couple of books. Literally anything stacked on my desk that isn't for classes. This place has shitty cable, and I'm not about to buy an issue of Good Housekeeping just to have something to read.
Very specific. I'll try not to screw it up.
Ember sent crazy face emojis and a heart, followed by, You're the best. See you soon. Cheyenne just sent her a thumbs up and stuck her phone back into her pocket. Then she strapped herself in and got the hell out of the business park. It took her about 20 minutes to get back to the north side of Jackson Ward and Ember's apartment. There weren't that many people out and about yet, at least in the apartment complex. She walked through the hallway on the ground floor, which was open to the air, and stopped at the last apartment on the left. After squatting to lift the corner of the doormat, she pulled the spare key out from underneath and unlocked the door. First floor. That'll make things easier when they let her out. Ember's apartment was almost the exact opposite of Cheyenne's, because the Fae grad student had furniture in her living room, with brightly colored throw pillows and everything. It smelled like lavender hand soap and the Nag Champa incense beside the small pot of bamboo on a table by the window. The halfling went straight back to the bedroom and rummaged through her friend's drawers, tossing everything that might work onto the blue bedspread covered in gray stars. When she found the underwear drawer, she paused. I should bring her some handmade troll lingerie. She burst out laughing, grabbed a handful of underwear from the drawer, and tossed that on the bed, too. A quick search through the closet netted her another tote bag, and Cheyenne stuffed everything into it. Without bothering to look at the titles, she grabbed the top three books stacked on the desk beside the bed, then headed into the bathroom. Damn, she keeps things clean in here. There wasn't even a toothbrush on the counter by the sink, and she had to search through the medicine cabinet on top and the one below before she found the toiletries bag. She opened it to make sure it had what Ember needed, then shrugged and tossed the small zipped bag into the tote with everything else. As she slung the bag over her shoulder and stepped into the hall to leave, her drow hearing picked up heavy footsteps from the open hallway outside. She didn't think anything of it until the footsteps came all the way down the row of apartments and stopped outside the last door on the left. Ember's. Cheyenne slowly lowered the bag off her shoulder. The doorknob turned. She dropped the tote. By the time the front door to Ember's apartment burst open, the halfling had already let the heat of her drow magic race up her spine and take over, just in time for a tall, gangly troll to storm inside. There was a disturbingly yellow tint around the edges of his purple eyes and lips, which he licked nervously. A bright orange skaxen with long, greasy red hair falling over his shoulders stepped in behind the troll. Now that looks like a rat. The door slammed behind them, and it took the intruders a moment to see the drow halfling standing in the hallway to the bedroom. Cheyenne summoned a crackling black orb of energy with bright purple churning at the core, and cocked her head. Bet you were expecting someone else, huh? The troll let out a high-pitched giggle.
Just you, Morukare.
Chapter 4. A spark of neon yellow light burst from his fingertips and streaked across the living room. Cheyenne's enhanced speed kicked in, and she stepped sideways to avoid the attack of sickly electric magic. When time sped up again, she stood 2 feet from where the troll's spell cracked against the back of the hallway. A burst of drywall puffed out into the living room. The halfling shrugged. Your aim sucks. Then she launched her black sphere at the troll's chest. He dove out of the way just before her magic blasted the edge of a cabinet above the stove, splintering the wood and ripping the door off the hinges.
You think sneaking Earthside is gonna hide you from us?
The Skaxon leered at her, his words whistling through the many gaps between his razor-sharp teeth.
The Ogul Eye searches across more than one world, Morukare, and the head follows.
With surprising speed, the Skaxon leaped onto the kitchen counter, knocking down a jar of loose change and hissing like a rat. The thick silver chain lurched out from beneath his shirt, another bull's head pendant dangling off it. Let me guess, you're talking about cattle. Purple sparks flared at the tips of Cheyenne's fingers, but she waited a little longer. Whatever the hell he just said, he thinks I know what it means. The Skaxon whipped something that looked like an AA battery out of his jacket pocket and raised it like he meant to throw the thing. A dark shimmer erupted from his hand and trembled there before slowly growing. He shrieked in excitement, spit flying from his bright orange lips. "Looks like your spells are stalling on you, asshole." The halfling went to toss sparks at the idiot, just to see what he'd do after his totally unnecessary jump onto the counter, but the troll had pushed himself back to his feet and summoned another piss-yellow bolt of energy. The light it gave off was the same color as the yellowing skin around his mouth. Cheyenne let him get closer before she whipped her hand out toward him. Black tendrils of magic shot from her fingertips and writhed across the living room. The first one coiled around his wrist and jerked it aside. The spell hurtled into the beige couch, sending orange throw pillows and puffs of feathers in every direction. Then she balled her fist and yanked the troll off his feet. The black tendrils coiled around both his ankles and the other shoulder. He screamed as she hurled him across the living room toward the wall beside the TV stand. First he crashed into the wall, then he dropped and almost knocked the flat-screen TV to the floor. She thought about trying to save her friend's furniture, but then the skaxon leaped from the counter and screeched. More spit flew from his mouth. Mostly to avoid the stench and whatever messed-up diseases the rat-like skaxon carried in his mouth, Cheyenne slipped into her enhanced speed mode again and stepped aside. The slavering orange magical sailed through the air, his beady eyes focused on where she'd just been standing. He still clenched that weird battery in his clawed hand, and the growing circle of black light expanded faster than it should have, with its caster suspended. What is that? Cheyenne shot her black tendrils toward the flying skaxon and coiled them around his middle. The rest of the world sped back up as she jerked him down out of the air and smashed him into the carpeted floor. The skaxon screamed when she launched him back up and maybe broke his back against the apartment's ceiling. More drywall and plaster came down with him as she bashed the magical one more time into the floor. The battery thing sailed from his hand toward the window and vanished, drawing the black circle of light into it with a little pop. After withdrawing her writhing whips of drow magic, the halfling stopped and allowed herself a moment to survey the damage. Gotta quit fighting these assholes in other people's apartments. The skaxon wheezed and coughed out a spray of spit and what looked a lot like orange blood. But he lay still after that and didn't look like he'd be getting back up anytime soon. The troll, lying in a heap beside the TV stand, tried to growl at her, but it came out more like a groan. Cheyenne stormed across the living room toward him, summoning another black orb to keep his attention. The troll's red-black eyes, the whites now taking on the same yellow tinge, rolled as he clung to consciousness. When she saw the glint of another thick chain beneath the guy's t-shirt, she bent and yanked the rest of the chain out so she could see it. She shook the bull pendant and snarled, "Wanna tell me what the hell this is?" After a quick, surprised blink, the troll burst into more high-pitched cackling with a little rasping at the end.
"More of us hear the call every day, Morukare. Now that she has your scent, the rest will be coming for you. And trust me, there are way more of us now than there were before the crossing."
She tossed the pendant against his chest and straightened.
"Now that who has my scent?"
Another creepy giggle burst from the troll.
"You're as stupid as you look."
"Yeah, you too." The halfling closed her fist around the sizzling orb of black energy and smashed it into the troll's skull. He thumped against the TV stand, causing the flat screen, which had already come precariously close to falling off, to wobble again. Cheyenne's hand clamped on the corner of the TV, and she swiveled it back into place. Then she stepped away from her unconscious attacker and shot the skaxon another glance. That was easy. She stepped back into the hallway to pick up the tote of Ember's things and slung it across her shoulder. An automatic grimace passed over her face. But when she realized the black magic holes in her shoulder were as healed as they'd been in the dungeon, she snorted. That was the only good thing to come out of that little visit, and I can't waste my time with these idiots. When she didn't hear any other footsteps coming down the walkway outside, she reached into the other pocket of her jacket and pulled open the Frow burner phone. There were only two numbers on there, which made it a lot easier to know which belonged to whom. Cheyenne hesitated for a second, then shrugged and called the second number. They owe me, and they know it. Reinhardt picked up on the third ring.
I don't have to tell you how weird it is to see this number pop up on my phone.
This isn't my favorite call to make either.
What do you want, rookie?
You people have got to start some kind of cleanup crew. A wry laugh came over the line.
I'll send the suggestion up to my superiors. You get yourself in some magical-on-magical trouble?
More like they tried to bring the trouble to me, and failed.
How stupid of them.
There was another long pause, then Reinhardt chuckled.
All right, rookie, text me the address and I'll send someone over. Just hang out until my guys show up.
Better not take all day.
You're welcome.
He hung up and Cheyenne just rolled her eyes. But she texted him Ember's address and shoved the phone back into her jacket pocket. Great. Now I get to babysit. 40 minutes later, the front door opened again. Two Frow operatives in black fatigue stepped into Ember's apartment to find the drow halfling slumped on the beige couch in the living room, one arm thrown over the back. There was a huge, charred hole in the fabric, and feathers everywhere. Two goblins this time, and one of them was the abnormally tall, muscular one with the yellow braid down the center of his head and the giant bull ring in his nose. The shorter goblin shut the door behind them and let out a low whistle.
Stepped into the wrong apartment, huh?
The female voice coming from the shorter goblin surprised Cheyenne. This one's head was shaved bald, showing the scars on her scalp. Only when she turned to look at the halfling did Cheyenne see the eye patch over the goblin's right eye.
Something like that.
The tall goblin with the bull ring chuckled and nodded for his partner to start what they'd come here to do with the two unconscious thugs on the floor. Then he made his way toward Cheyenne on the couch and stuck out his hand.
If Reinhardt had told me we'd find you here, I probably wouldn't have bitched so much about being put on maid duty.
The halfling stood. She didn't think she'd actually shake the goblin's hand until she did.
I'm guessing you guys know more about how to take out the trash than I do.
Probably, yeah.
The sound of the troll's body thumping onto the floor made them both turn. The female goblin had pulled the unconscious magical away from the stand and now knelt beside him as she unfastened a pair of dampening cuffs from the loop at her belt. She paused, looking up at Cheyenne and Bullring, and muttered,
"What are you losers staring at?"
Cheyenne snorted. I like her.
Yeah, Peyton's been a real dick since that imp's dagger took out her eye.
Peyton rolled her good eye and didn't even try to be gentle while jerking the unconscious troll's arms behind his back.
I was a real stand-up goblin before that.
The halfling smirked.
Oh yeah?
No.
The one-eyed operative clamped the dampening cuffs together with a metallic click and pushed to her feet to head toward the skaxon.
We'll take care of these idiots, Bullring said before taking another sweeping glance of Ember's apartment. Not sure we can do anything about the walls, though. Or the couch.
Don't worry about it. I didn't think Frow Special Forces were trained in redecorating anyway.
The tall goblin let out a gruff laugh and folded his arms.
You know, I wasn't sure about you till I saw the way you blasted through those bastards at the church the other night. These two were probably a walk in the park compared to that, but I'm still impressed.
Yeah, thanks.
My newest Frow fan, huh? Yeah, this isn't weird.
I'm Yorick.
He nodded at her, and Cheyenne nodded back. not quite ready to give him her name just yet, whether or not Sir and Reinhardt had already shared it. Yorick tried to wipe the smirk off his lips.
You got a phone on you?
She frowned. How else do you think I called for backup?
Let me see it.
The goblin gestured for her to cough it up, and Cheyenne gladly pulled the burner phone from her jacket pocket before dropping it into Yorick's outstretched turquoise hand. He flipped it open and started typing, thankfully without any comments about the crappy flip phone. When he was done, he snapped the phone shut again and handed it back.
All right, now you have my number, just in case you make another mess and need to call in a crew.
Cheyenne pocketed the phone with a crooked smile. Is maid your new official title?
Nice try. It's the least I can do, given the way you helped round up those kid killers and their black magic bullshit. I don't offer that service to just anybody.
Right. Well, I appreciate it.
Looks like we're on the same page, then.
Yorick chuckled again, his yellow eyes glinting at her.
Hey, pretty boy,
Peyton called from where she stooped over the knocked-out Skaxon. The dampening cuffs clamped down around those bright orange wrists, and the goblin grunted.
Unless you want to cough up your MREs for the next week, cut it out with the chatting and do your job.
Yorick scoffed and turned a crooked smile on his partner.
You need help cuffing two idiots who can't even move?
You need me to beat your ass? Again?
I better get out of here. Cheyenne grabbed the tote full of Ember's things off the couch and nodded at Yorick as she made her way across the living room. Thanks for the cleanup.
No problem.
She couldn't help herself when she passed the one-eyed goblin on her way to the door. Nice to meet you, Peyton. The goblin sent a half-assed kick into the Skaxon's ribs and muttered,
Fuck off.
With a snort, Cheyenne opened the door and stepped out into the open-air hallway of the apartment building. Before she forgot, she locked the door from the inside and left it cracked a little before returning the spare key to its place under the mat. The halfling slipped back into human goth grad student just as Ember's neighbor across the hall opened his front door. The guy froze, then shut his eyes and tried to shake off what he'd just seen.
Did you just...
Cheyenne lifted her chin and gave him a tight smile. Nice morning, huh? She didn't wait for a response before heading back down the hall toward the parking lot. For having been attacked by a couple of crazies who clearly thought she was someone else, Cheyenne felt pretty good, even if she was apparently digging herself deeper and deeper into the fray when she really wanted the exact opposite. Whatever makes it easier to squeeze what I want out of L'zar, because I will. Chapter 5. Ember pushed herself up a little straighter in the hospital bed when Cheyenne stepped through the door of room 317. The Fae shot her friend a wide grin. I was starting to think you'd gone back to sleep or something. Nope, just got a little hung up. The halfling slipped the tote off her shoulder, and Ember patted the bed beside her. When she reached into the bag, she looked like a kid opening presents on Christmas morning, all grinning and wide-eyed, until she pulled out the books.
Cheyenne.
Yeah?
What the hell is this?
You said any of the books on your desk, so I grabbed the ones on top and stuck them in. Ember pulled out the first and turned it so her friend could see the cover.
The Grapes of Wrath? Seriously?
How was I supposed to know you weren't in the mood for Steinbeck? It's better than good housekeeping. The halfling pulled the uncomfortable armchair up beside the bed and lifted herself into it, crossing her legs beneath her.
I'm in the hospital and I can't walk. Reading's supposed to help me escape, not make me even more depressed.
Cheyenne couldn't hold back a little laugh. It's not that depressing. I like that kind of stuff. When I feel like reading. Ember puffed out a sigh through loose lips and took in the sight of her friend. Black shirt, black pants, heavy black eye makeup, chains around her wrists, and all the piercings.
Yeah, you would. I didn't know you liked reading much of anything.
I don't. I'll go back later and get you something about rainbows and unicorns if you want. Ha. Huh. The Fae rolled her eyes and shoved the book back into her bag. It's fine. Thanks for picking all this up for me. Nothing I couldn't handle. Not a lie. So, question. Go. Who else knows about you being a third-generation Earthside Fae with no magic? Ember shot her friend a curious frown. You mean besides my whole family, who wishes I didn't exist just to shame the bloodline? You? And then, well, Trevor and his other halfling friends, who left you to bleed out without a second thought? Cheyenne cleared her throat. Anyone else? It's not the best conversation starter. The Fae shot her friend a sidelong glance. And it's not like I have anything to hide. Not like you. Hey, what's that supposed to mean? I just mean the whole trying not to let the pointy ears stick out of all that hair thing. Shaking her head, Ember let out a small laugh and scooted the tote of her things up the bed so she could throw her arm over it. You know what I mean. Why? Who brought it up? No one brought it up exactly. The halfling scratched the back of her head. I ran into a little trouble at your apartment. Just wondering if anyone else knew what you were and thought they'd come to find you or something. What kind of trouble? I took care of it. It's fine. Cheyenne. Ember folded her arms and shot her friend a stern look. Remember when I told you you're a really bad liar? Okay, fine. A couple of scumbags showed up at your place looking for a fight. The halfling chuckled. And I gave it to them. They did what now? Well, I'm pretty sure they were just trying to get to me if no one else knows about you. I guess they wouldn't have been spouting all that weird shit about eyes following me and some lady who apparently found my scent. Cheyenne shrugged and picked at a black painted nail. You're kidding. Nope. I have no idea what those guys were going on about, but they seemed pretty sure I was someone else. The halfling tapped her chest. And they had these weird pendants in the shape of a bull's head. I've been seeing them on a lot of messed up magicals running around. Any idea what they mean? Ember sighed and brushed her hair away from her face. No clue. Sounds like a bunch of crazy to me. Yeah, that's what I thought. But L'zar said it was an issue that should have stayed in Umbaro Ghoul. Wait, wait, wait. Back up. L'zar? Cheyenne looked up from her nails and broke into a crooked smile. Oh, yeah. Maybe I should have started with that. You think? Did you go see him? This morning. Ember smacked her hands together and bounced a little in the hospital bed. How is that not the first thing you tell me when you walk in the door? Come on! Sorry. Cheyenne laughed. I know it's not even noon, but it's already been a weird day. No shit. Tell me everything. The halfling took in her friend's surprising eagerness and debated saying anything, but only for a second. At least someone cares. It definitely didn't go the way I expected. Ember snorted. What did you expect? I don't know. An apology, maybe? More of an explanation for why he just left my mom instead of some bullshit excuse? Which was? Cheyenne rolled her eyes and did her best impression of Lazar's low, apathetic voice.
Because I had to.
Oh, come on. I know. And that's how the whole conversation went. I mean, it wasn't even a real conversation. Just a bunch of vague answers and him laughing at me. The worst part is, he didn't even ask about my mom. Like, not a single thing. And then he said he didn't want to hear about her because I was more interesting. Ember's jaw dropped and she blinked. What a dick. Cheyenne shrugged. Yeah, that's pretty much the conclusion I came to. Another short laugh escaped her. What? Ember leaned toward her, eyes wide with curiosity. I said this safe word that turned on the alarm and put him under lockdown. Red lights, siren, turned the bars of his cell into a giant bug zapper for magicals. Good. The Fae barked a laugh. Bet that pissed him off. No, he just laughed like the whole thing was just one big game and he just wanted to see what I'd do. Whoa. Leaning back against the propped-up bed and all the pillows behind her, Ember let out a long sigh. You gonna go see him again? No clue. I'm not even sure I want to think about that right now. I have other things going on that feel more important. Oh yeah? Like what? Cheyenne pressed her lips together and tried not to laugh. Well, for starters, I'm gonna have to find the time to go back to your place and clean up the little mess I made. Little mess? Squinting, the halfling slowly met her friend's blue-eyed gaze. Medium small, maybe. Hey, I saved the TV, so there's that. Lovely. Ember plastered on a tight smile. Please tell me the bamboo survived. I promise, no plants were harmed in the ass-kicking of the magical intruders. Cheyenne drew a cross over her heart, and they both laughed. Dunno if your couch survived. Maybe if you get it reupholstered. Nah, I wanted a new one anyway. Cool. I'll buy you new pillows, too. Ember barked out a laugh. How did my pillows get pulled into a fight? We don't have to go into details. With another chuckle, Cheyenne shook her head and thought about Yorick and Peyton in her friend's apartment. But all the evidence got taken care of. Oh, and I almost forgot the most important thing. The Fae threw her arms in the air and let them drop back into her lap with a thump. It better not be worse than blowing up my living room with drow magic. No, it's way better. Licking her lips, Cheyenne leaned toward the bed and took a deep breath. Guess who I found on the... A light knock came at the door, then Dr. Andrews stepped into Ember's hospital room and paused. Oh, you're back. Hey, Doc. The halfling shot him a sarcastic salute. This guy has the worst timing. Just coming in to check on my favorite patient in room 317. The doctor closed the door behind him and walked slowly toward the bed, his tablet cradled in the crook of his arm. Well, you're here, though. How's the shoulder? Oh, yeah. It's feeling great, actually. Good work. Nodding quickly, Cheyenne slid out of the armchair and pushed it back into place against the wall beside the window. Ember shot her a confused look. It's feeling great? The halfling leaned in to wrap Ember in a quick hug and whispered in her friend's ear, L'zar, I'll tell you about it later. She pulled back and gave the Fae's shoulders a squeeze. Now that you have your personal effects, I gotta get going. Happy reading, right? She shot Ember a wink, and her friend rolled her eyes. Oh, jeez. See you later, Doc. Keep up the good work with my friend. She deserves it. Nodding at the confused doctor, Cheyenne patted the foot of the bed as she stepped around it and headed for the door. You know, if you want me to take another look at your shoulder, I'm happy to... No thanks. I'm good. Enjoy your Sunday. She slipped out of the door and headed quickly down the hall. That guy gets nosier every time I see him, and I have more work to do. She wished she could have at least told Ember she was finally about to bash in the front door of the orc scumbag who shot her, but the look on her friend's face when Cheyenne gave her the news afterward would be just as satisfying. Chapter 6. Glenn finished booting up in Cheyenne's tiny living room just as the microwave beeped. She went to grab the steaming tray of now-unfrozen enchiladas from the convenience store down the street. The silverware drawer was empty, all the forks either in the sink or tossed haphazardly in the dishwasher. She pulled open the junk drawer in the kitchen, rummaged around, and snatched a plastic fork wrapped in more plastic with salt and pepper packets. No downside to takeout. She brought it all back to her computer setup,
dropped into her chair, and set the enchiladas down to cool off just a little. Getting her VPN and the torrent fired up to hop onto the dark web took her no time at all, and then she was right back in the Borderlands forum to search for a few more things before her long-awaited reunion with Derg. This time, I'm going in prepared. She skimmed through the newest topics, looking for anything about the area of Jackson Ward just on the other side of the skate park. One of the topics, titled Bombs Underground Gets Freaky on East Clay, caught her eye, only because that street was just blocks from the skate park. But apparently, Bombs Underground was actually a heavy metal band with all magical members that was set to play at some tiny little venue a block down from Gnarly's pub. She wrinkled her nose and went ahead with leaving a comment just to see what might stick. Shyhand 71. Sounds like fun. Hey, has anybody put together a magicals-only list of where people are? You know, like for networking or something? The minute she posted it, she let out a grunt of disgust. I sound like such a noob. The other users on the Borderlands forum were just as quick to jump to the same conclusion. Hold my grog, 911. At Cheyenne 71. You trying to get us all together in one spot so we can hold hands and make a big-ass target for the F-Force? Looks like somebody's trip Earthside fried all their brain cells. Too magic to quit. At Cheyenne 71, I call Narc right there. Fists for days. At Cheyenne 71, we went through the reservations, dumbass. Why would we want more eyes on us when they already have us in the goddamn system? What the hell's wrong with you? Crown Undone 21. Okay, everybody throwing their insecurities at a new commenter, and I'm pretty sure at Cheyenne 71's new around here, needs to back the hell up and calm down. It was an innocent question. I'm pretty sure there are running lists somewhere, maybe not by area where people live now, but I think I saw something maybe a year ago that had groups by trade, either back home or Earthside, can't remember. At Cheyenne 71, I'll take a look around and hit you up here if I find anything. Can't cuff this. I second everything at Crown Undone 21 just said to all the haters. By the crown, y'all hopped on this comment quickly. I thought we came Earthside to avoid the bloodshed, not to sit behind computer screens and try to draw more of it. At Cheyenne 71's right to ask, especially if they're new. Not everyone who made the crossing logs onto the fucking dark web to come watch you assholes make a circus of the Borderlands. Lay off. Fists for days. At Crown Undone 21, at Can't Cuff This, you trying to be peacekeepers now? I sure as shit could have used some backup 2 months ago when my shop got raided. Oh yeah, that's right. Everyone's a damn hero when all they have to do is sit down at a keyboard and play around. Whoa. Cheyenne lifted her hands from her keyboard and watched the comments roll in, one right after the other. Hit a sore spot, huh? With a shrug, she leaned back over the keys and left one more comment. Otherwise, she really would look like just another troll trying to stir up shit where it wasn't needed. Cheyenne 71. At Crown Undone 21. At Can't Cuff This. Thanks. I'll keep looking. Feel free to DM me if you find something that might help. We can leave the peanut gallery out of it. Can't Cuff This. At Cheyenne 71. Yeah, just ignore those guys. They're probably still shaking off the smell of whatever res they just got themselves booted out of. You brought up a good point. It's good to keep an eye open for ways we can help each other. Nodding, Cheyenne clicked out of that particular topic thread, not wanting to waste her time reading through whatever other angry comments anyone else left her. She ran a search on the forum for anything about Jackson Ward. But before she could sort through the results, a private chat box popped up in the top corner of her monitor.
She'd expected something else from Guardian 104, who she now knew was the Night Stalker, Corian, mainly because the guy always seemed to be on the Borderlands forum when she was, and generally hit her with a message. But this new chat box had come directly from the user handle Crown Down for What? Who the heck is that? The halfling hadn't seen the handle before on any of the open topics or in comment threads, though of course she hadn't been through all of them. The message, though, was even more confusing. Crown down for what?
Just saw your comment about lists of people in certain areas. I might be able to help if you tell me why you're looking.
Huh. Cheyenne cocked her head, frowned, then scooted a little closer to the desk and started typing again. Cheyenne 71. Just thought it might be helpful. I'm sure other people would appreciate knowing what kind of neighborhood they're stepping into. Where to find friends. Who to stay away from. Crown down for what?
Well, you're definitely not the first to come up with the idea. You stepping into a new neighborhood or something?
Cheyenne 71. Kind of. I just want to make sure I'm not about to put all my eggs in one basket before somebody steps on it. Crown down for what?
I hear ya. What neighborhood?
Cheyenne 71. Jackson Ward. North Side, mostly. Her new friend took over a minute to reply. Cheyenne managed to sit patiently through the wait, hoping whoever it was had enough balls to tell her to scram if they didn't want to dig any deeper into this with her. Then a new message popped up at the bottom of the chat. Crown down for what?
Maybe this'll help. It's a section of a longer list I have access to, and that's just one list of a lot more. If you have any other questions, I'm here.
Cheyenne rolled her eyes. Why can't people just put it in the chat instead of making me do all the work? She fired up the bunker again, because she had no idea who this crown down for what was, and was too smart not to cover her bases. A link was a link, sure, but on the dark web, it could literally be anything else, too. Once her custom program had fully opened, she clicked on the link and downloaded Crown Down for What's little present through a BitTorrent and right in. 5 seconds later, the new file had been tested and scrubbed of nothing. It was as clean as the file Guardian 104 had sent her on Derg, and it was just as small. A list of names and races, identified by class, took up 3/4 of a page. Some of them had addresses, and several had professions listed after that. There were apparently only 20 or so other magicals listed in Jackson Ward altogether, not just the North Side. She scanned the list again and clicked back into the chat. Cheyenne 71. Definitely helpful. How long ago was this list updated?
Crown down for what?
About 20 seconds ago. My system's pretty thorough. Cheyenne 71. Nice. Any tips for how a noob can get access to systems like that?
Crown down for what?
You don't have to pretend like you don't know what you're doing. The way you've been answering my questions proves enough. Wish I could help with more than sending over a list now and then. Built the system myself, though. Not looking to bring in partners.
No kidding.
The halfling couldn't help being a little impressed by that, if Crown Down for What was telling the truth. Looks like I'm not the only one who knows their way around serious coding. Cheyenne 71.
Makes sense. I appreciate the file anyway.
Crown Down for What?
No worries. Let me know if you're stepping into any other neighborhoods and want the same kind of info. You'll eventually get the hang of working this stuff out on your own. When you've been Earthside as long as I have, you get real good at keeping a bird's eye view.
Cheyenne 71.
Just for fun, how long have you been here?
Crown down for what?
Longer than the Accord. Not safe to say much more than that.
Cheyenne 71.
Right. I'll keep in touch.
Crown down for what?
Sounds good.
Cheyenne sat back in her office chair and read over their conversation one more time.
Longer than the Accord, huh? So, before I was born, and before the Fro started making their own lists,
who is this guy? It made her curious, but it wasn't the most important thing right now. She had the information she wanted about Derg's neighborhood, and she had some time to kill, thanks to her new friend from the Borderlands Forum. And no stupid scavenger hunts first. I like this guy. It took her another 15 minutes to cross-reference the addresses on that list with the area of Jackson Ward where Derg lived. There were other orcs living in the area, and all of them were at least 4 blocks away from her new target's house. Those with listed jobs mostly worked on the other side of Richmond. If she wanted to make certain most of them were out of the way, she would wait until tomorrow, skip class, and go for the bastard in the middle of the day. Cheyenne rubbed her forehead and glanced at her backpack on the floor by the kitchen counter's half wall. Can't keep skipping. And most people are home on a Sunday night anyway. Especially the orc she was bent on paying back for what he'd done to Ember. Chapter 7. No matter how badly she was itching to head to Derg's place, which would have only taken her about 25 minutes to walk and maybe 2 minutes to run at full drow speed, Cheyenne did the smart thing and waited it out. She glanced at the clock on her computer. 5:47 p.m. Might as well warm up. She shut off the monitor and powered Glenn down all the way before stepping into the tiny space between her desk and her kitchen. After a second's thought, she let the heat of her drow magic flare at the base of her spine and wash over her. Then she conjured up the purple sparks shooting off the tips of her fingers and stared at them. How about something I haven't mastered yet? The sparks went out, and she closed her eyes to take herself back to her final test with Reinhardt the day before. Black fire on my skin. How the hell does that work? The halfling tried to bring up the protective rage she'd felt fighting Reinhardt's mountain of an ogre operative. Jamal's face pulled up quickly in her memory, his sneer, the mottled gray flesh covering his lumpy head, the way he'd dropped to one knee in the middle of their fight and given up. 'Cause it was a lie. She clenched her fists and opened her eyes, hoping to see the black flames flickering across her black shirt and the purple-gray skin of her forearms showing beneath her 3/4-length sleeves. Nothing. One and done, then. What about the shield? The chains on her wrists clinked when she shook out her hands. Then she shot out her arm and threw her hand toward the window at the far end of her tiny living room. Takes more than intention, huh? With a sigh, Cheyenne focused harder on what a shield was supposed to be, protection and a last-minute defense. She sucked in a breath and spun, raising both hands toward the closet just inside the front door. The doorknob might have rattled a little, but that was it. Then a muted golden glow sputtered inside her backpack on the floor, and the halfling pointed at it. Uh-uh, I'm not dealing with that tonight. There was a knock on her front door, and she started. The knock was repeated. Yeah, I'm coming. Hold on. When she passed her backpack, she wanted to send a swift kick into the thing to get the copper puzzle box to quit flashing light. Nobody else needs to see that. But her laptop was in there, too, so she just gave the thing a less-than-gentle nudge with the side of her foot and smirked when the golden light winked out. Then she slipped out of her drow form and slowly opened the door. It didn't surprise her all that much to find one of her troll neighbors on the other side of it. Cheyenne! Ramar grinned at her, his deep scarlet eyes lighting up because she'd answered. I hope this is a good time. Yaji's almost finished with the cooking, and we would love to invite you into our home now to join us. Right now? The troll cocked his head, his grin fading into a confused smile. Yes, it's Sunday. I mentioned this the other day, and you, well, I thought.
I never said no.
Cheyenne nodded and shot him as much of a reassuring smile as she could manage. Yeah. Okay. You guys already started cooking and everything? Ramar nodded vigorously. As close to the food back home as we could get.
I don't know how Yaji does it with what little we can find at the bazaar, but she makes it work. You'll be very happy with it.
Yeah, I bet. They stood there awkwardly on either side of her door. Then Ramar's gaze drifted to her right toward the basket of all that brightly colored underwear they'd made her.
You still have our gift.
Yep. Cheyenne followed his gaze and had to keep herself from laughing.
I can't get rid of a present like that, can I?
The troll's grin returned with full force, and he let out a satisfied little chuckle.
Yaji will be so glad to hear you've found a use for them.
Okay, let's head on over to your place, huh? Not wanting to be rude, the halfling opened the door all the way before slipping into her black Vans that were tossed against the closet. Then she hurried quickly out of her apartment and shut the door.
After you?
Yes, well, it's not very far. The troll shot her an amused glance and chuckled again, shaking his head at the worn, stained carpet lining the hallway of the second floor.
I told Yaji you would be very pleased to walk inside and have this meal already prepared. She wasn't convinced you were coming, you know.
Good thing I cleared my schedule, then. Yaji had a better grip on how to make plans. Still plenty of time before dark. The troll's head bobbed up and down, his long scarlet hair bouncing against his back. They passed the two other apartments between them, and he stopped at his front door to shoot the drow halfling another wide grin full of clean but crooked teeth.
We're honored to have you here with us.
No problem. I'm honored to be invited. Can't break the guy's heart over this. Ramar sucked in a sharp breath, his eyes growing even wider as he whispered,
"Thank you."
Then he opened the door and gestured for her to step inside first. A thick wave of pungent spices almost knocked her over when Cheyenne stepped into the troll family's home. The air was filled with the sizzle of something frying on the stove beside a thick something else boiling in a huge pot. Ramar ushered her in even farther and closed the door. He clapped his hands and almost scampered toward the kitchen.
Our guest is here, Yaji. She's here. How much longer for the meal?
You can't hurry perfection, Yaji snapped from the kitchen, completely hidden by the wall jutting out from the entryway.
I'll finish it when I finish it, and you'll just have to keep your greedy little hands out.
A sharp smack was followed by Ramar's exclamation of surprise and his wife laughing. Then Yaji poked her head around the corner and settled her scarlet gaze on the halfling standing just inside the door.
Make yourself at home, Fermor. We won't be much longer.
Sure. The halfling nodded, but the woman's head had already disappeared back into the kitchen. Raising her eyebrows, Cheyenne took in the family's living room, which looked more or less like it had the first time she'd stepped inside under much more urgent circumstances. Ramar and his family had made quick work of patching up the place. The planter hanging from the ceiling had been put back together with an insane amount of duct tape coating the bottom. The plant returned to its place after having been blasted by drow magic. The leaves drooped sadly over the mended plastic sides of the planter. More duct tape had been applied liberally to the broken leg of the armchair, as well as added for extra hold around two different pieces of thin plywood already nailed to the walls. Cheyenne still felt a little draft from the covered hole in the wall beside the door. If they're happy with it, guess it works.
Hi.
The halfling glanced quickly across the room and found Brill sitting on the floor in front of the sunken couch, an open book laid across her lap.
Hey, your parents really went all out with the duct tape, huh?
The young troll glanced around the room and sighed.
It's one of their favorite new things on this side.
Yeah, well, it's good for a lot of things. Glad they figured that out, at least.
Holding back a laugh, Cheyenne moved across the living room and stopped beside the girl, dipping her head to take a look at the book.
What are you reading?
Brill shrugged.
Harry Potter.
Oh, yeah,
the halfling said as she wrinkled her nose and let out a little chuckle.
It's a good story.
but they didn't get any of the magic parts right.
Cheyenne laughed and covered it with a hand, rubbing her mouth. Well, it's made up. Kind of fun to think about things in a different way.
I guess.
Brill, put that thing away and come help me set the table. Yaji waved her daughter into the kitchen. With a small, knowing smile, the kid looked up at Cheyenne and tossed her book aside before going to help her parents. Turning toward the kitchen, Cheyenne spread her arms and figured she might as well be a part of this while she was here. I can help, too.
Oh, no.
Yaji shook her head and pulled her daughter into the kitchen.
Absolutely not.
Ramar rounded the corner, waving his hands furiously like he was trying to flag somebody down on the highway.
No, the Fermor won't lift a finger in our home.
You can just call me Cheyenne, really.
The Fermor Cheyenne was not invited here to help. You've done that and more already.
Ramar hurried toward her and settled his hands on her shoulders before steering her toward the wooden table with legs so thin it didn't look like it would be able to hold much of anything. He pulled out a chair and pointed.
You will sit right here.
She didn't try to fight him on that one and slowly lowered herself into the chair. It creaked and wobbled a little under her weight, and the halfling forced herself not to take up her usual position and lean all the way back with her feet stretched out in front of her under the table. I already broke too much of their stuff.
We'll take care of everything else.
Ramar gave her a firm nod and hurried back into the kitchen. A moment later, his wife stepped out into their makeshift dining room with a huge clay bowl piled high with something which looked like rice and noodles scrambled together, steam wafting off the top. She grinned and set the bowl in the center of the table, then disappeared again. Brill brought out the next plate of what was maybe pita bread, only with purple streaks running down the sides of the still warm pastry. The bowl Ramar brought out next had vegetables Cheyenne recognized. Bok choy and carrots and broccoli piled around something blue that couldn't have possibly been grown in this world. The dishes seemed never-ending as the troll family brought out one after another. The halfling rubbed the side of her face and gave up on trying to give each of them a genuine smile when they came toward her from the kitchen. Finally, when the wobbly table was sufficiently loaded with more food than they could possibly eat in one sitting, all three trolls moved quickly toward the other chairs around the table and slipped into them. Silence fell over the dining room. Ramar and Yaji beamed at Cheyenne with pride. Brill glanced at her parents and their guest, biting her purple lower lip to keep from laughing.
Now,
Yaji took a deep breath and pulled herself up straighter in the chair.
Our Fermor first.
Cheyenne, really.
Take whatever you like, and we'll begin.
The troll woman gestured toward the overloaded table. The halfling gazed at all the steaming dishes and lifted her shoulder in a hesitant shrug.
Was I supposed to bring the plates and silverware?
Ramar and Yaji burst out laughing, and Cheyenne couldn't tell if it was forced amusement or if they genuinely thought she was making a joke. Apparently, my ignorance is showing. A small, warm finger tapped her forearm on the table, and Brill mimed scooping up the food.
With your hands.
Oh. The halfling eyed the bowl of cooked vegetables and reached across the table to pull a carrot out of the pile. She stuck it in her mouth and almost choked on the heavy spices, but she managed to nod through her chewings as Ramar and Yaji watched her like their lives depended on it.
Yeah, that's good.
Yaji smacked her husband's arm with the back of her hand.
I told you she'd like it. You worry too much about everything and nothing.
Laughing, Ramar bobbed his head, picked up one of the pita bread-looking things, then passed the plate of them toward his wife. Then all the hands were dipping into all the bowls, and Cheyenne tried not to frown.
They think I know how this works.
Look.
Brill picked up a piece of bread and used it like a glove made of food.
Just do what I do.
The halfling was more than happy to follow the lead of a 6-year-old troll. Chapter 8. Cheyenne, have some more borsni. Yaji gestured toward the bowl of vegetables and the piles of blue something the halfling had avoided. No thanks. I think I saw it glowing.
That's where all the flavor is.
Brill grabbed one of the blue veggies that looked like a bioluminescent turnip and took a huge bite. A bright light flashed in her mouth, and Cheyenne shook her head. You were talking about your town, though. The halfling nodded at the troll couple and tore off another piece of bread that tasted a little like strawberries. I want to hear more about it. It was a fine place, Ramar replied, nodding quickly. Such a beautiful place in the Aronti Valley. So many redon with their bright coats. That's how we used to get so much of the color for our houses, you know. Soak the redon pelts in river water, and you have the color to put on whatever you want. Here, I think you just buy it in cans. Paint? Yes, that's it.
We were very happy there, Yaji added. The best place to raise a family.
Cheyenne scooped up another handful of the rice noodle stuff. The trolls had had to assure her 3 times there was nothing alive in there when the noodles started moving on their own, and popped it all into her mouth. So why did you leave? Ramar paused with his hand halfway to his mouth, then jammed his next bite between his lips and avoided the question by chewing. Yaji shared a glance with her husband and dipped her head.
It was no longer safe.
What happened? Ramar swallowed thickly and sighed. You know the crown has different ideas of the places under their rule, Cheyenne. I doubt a single one of them ever made it out to Opel to see our home for themselves, but they wanted it for the reaping, all the same. Sorry. The halfling licked heavily spiced sauce off her lips. I don't know what that is.
Then you're a very lucky Fermor.
Yaji gave her a stern look, then reached for more food.
We left before things became too difficult. I'm not sure many of the others were as prepared to do what was necessary.
You mean crossing the border? Cheyenne looked back and forth between Ramar and Yaji, neither of whom would look up at her as they kept chewing. That's a definite yes. I thought it was fun. Brill brushed the shorter scarlet hairs away from her forehead, but they kept falling back into place.
An adventure, just like Dahi said.
You were an excellent adventurer, Brill. Ramar winked at his daughter, but the smile was just for show.
We walked for days through the woods to get to the portal.
Brill rested both elbows on the table and looked up at Cheyenne with wide scarlet eyes.
Built shelters every night. There wasn't always water close by, but when we found the river, there was plenty to drink.
Really? The halfling raised her eyebrows, waiting to hear more.
Yeah, and that was the easy part.
The kid grinned and lifted both hands to animate her story.
The border is like its own world. We had to say the spell on one side. I messed up, but Dahi reminded me. Then, when you pass through, everything's all dark everywhere you look. And there are these things that come out of the...
That's enough, Brill. Yaji shot her daughter a warning look.
But that's the best part, Maji.
Your mother said enough, Ninmel. Now Ramar shot the young girl the same look, and a bloom of dark purple spread across Brill's cheeks. Cheyenne doesn't want to hear about our journey through. His dark red eyes flickered toward the halfling before he had to look away. Reinhardt had said the crossing was rough, and they had done it with their kid. Brill bowed her head and dropped her hands into her lap, biting her lip to keep from saying anything else. There was a tense, awkward silence again, but this one wasn't in anticipation of starting the meal. Yaji took a sharp breath.
What did you think of the Aes Dur, Cheyenne?
Which one was that? Ramar let out a little chuckle as his wife pointed to a smaller dish of what looked like soup. The halfling had already figured out that when she touched the stuff, it hardened and drew itself into little round balls that tasted like chicken covered in chocolate.
Right. Yeah. It was different.
I know. The troll woman sighed and offered a shrug. I always try to find the best ingredients to make the same meals from home. Paradoche has so many wonderful things, but they're more focused on bringing in grog and fel wine and ingredients for spells than fresh ogulish foods. Cheyenne couldn't hold back a snort. Did you say fel wine? Ramar's hand came down on the table, making the whole thing wobble dangerously on its thin legs. He got a silent reminder to watch himself from his wife's quick glance. He ignored her.
You haven't had fel wine?
Nope. Can't say that I have.
Yaji, do you hear that? She's never had fel wine.
I heard her say it the first time. Yaji looked at the halfling and rolled her eyes.
We can't let her go any longer without tasting it.
The troll shook his head and puffed up his chest.
I told you we should have bought a flagon at Paradoche.
You say that every time, and we have more important things to spend our money on. You're brain-addled enough as it is. Ramar barked a laugh and clapped.
We'll have to change that, Cheyenne.
The halfling shrugged and couldn't help but smile.
Sounds like fun.
Not for you or anyone around you the next morning, Yaji added. Have you been to Paradoche?
No.
They must think I live in a box. Didn't even know it existed.
Richmond's very own Ogul Market.
Yaji licked the sauce from her fingers. We try to make it out there once a week.
A magicals-only type of place.
Ramar wiggled his eyebrows.
One of the only places we can get to these days where we don't have to hide everything about who we are. It's all out in the open at Paradoche, just like back home.
Suddenly feeling a lot fuller than she'd thought, Cheyenne leaned slowly back in the chair and folded her arms.
That's good to have around. How do they keep the place hidden?
Ha! Ramar gestured toward the halfling across the table and grinned at his wife.
She doesn't know.
That settles it, then. Yaji nodded at Cheyenne and grinned. You should come with us the next time we go.
Wednesday.
Ramar blinked, then turned toward his wife and leaned in.
That's it, isn't it?
Yes, Ramar. We go on Wednesdays.
Wednesday!
The troll grabbed a heaping handful of the remaining blue borsni and shoveled it into his mouth, chewing with overexcited enthusiasm.
You'll come with us, Cheyenne, and we'll show you the best Paradoche has to offer.
Yaji eyed the glowing bits of blue vegetable spilling from her husband's mouth and shook her head. He left his manners back in Umbarogul with everything else. Cheyenne laughed as Ramar waved off the insult.
I'll show you the potions tent,
Brill exclaimed, gripping the edge of the table in her excitement.
You'll love it. They have everything you can think of, like what you threw on that asshole orc last time you were.
Brill, her mother snapped, then added, watch your tongue.
What? The potion master says it all the time.
You're not the potion master, are you? Yaji raised an eyebrow, and her daughter made a face before dropping her gaze to the table again.
I'll show you when we go, Brill muttered, shooting Cheyenne a sideways glance.
Can't wait. The halfling's smile was tight as she tried not to alarm her odd magical hosts. Potions and kids haven't been a good mix lately.
Yes, yes.
Ramar just kept nodding, oblivious to his daughter's precocious cursing.
We'll show you everything. You'll be cooking ogulish meals in no time.
His wife snorted.
That's not a promise, Cheyenne. He's been going with me every week and still can't figure out how to cook a damas d'or.
Well, that's because I have you,
Ramar said, grinning at his wife. He leaned toward her again.
And you do it so very well.
She brushed him off and rolled her eyes, although her small smile broke through with the playful banter. Cheyenne glanced over her shoulder into the kitchen at the clock above the stove. After 9 already? I guess I did enjoy myself. Well, thanks for dinner. She grabbed the table to push herself up, but thought better of it when it wobbled. She scooted her chair back instead.
It was filling.
Yes, it sticks with you, eh? Chuckling, Ramar rose from the table and nodded.
Let me walk you to the door.
The halfling raised her hand toward Brill for a high five, and the girl didn't hesitate to smack her palm with a loud slap. Yaji gasped.
Brill!
Oh, no, it's okay. Cheyenne mimed another high five with herself this time. It's just a high five. A good thing here. The troll woman pressed her lips together and hummed in response. Then she forced a smile aimed at their guest.
Thank you for coming tonight, Cheyenne. Our door is always open to you.
Thanks. You guys already figured out you can knock on mine any time.
Yes, yes.
Ramar rounded the table and gestured across the living room. I'll walk you back to the door right now. You don't have to. I'm just down the hall.
I didn't leave all my manners on the other side of the border, Cheyenne, even though my wife thinks otherwise.
He shot Yaji another wink and laughed when she tossed the last piece of bread at him. Then he opened the door and gestured for the halfling to step out into the hall.
Don't forget about Wednesday, Brill called after them.
Not a chance.
Ramar walked beside her past the two apartments between them, patting his belly beneath another of his oversized t-shirts.
We are very glad you came to share a meal with us, Cheyenne. It means more than you can imagine, having a fermor in our home. A friend.
Yeah, I enjoyed it. She stopped beside her door and paused when she grabbed the handle. Then she turned back toward Ramar and took a deep breath. So I wouldn't feel right about it if I didn't say something. The troll's eyes widened in concern.
What happened? You really didn't like the Borsni, did you?
No, no. The Borsni was good. It's about the Paradosh market.
Oh, yes.
Cheyenne dropped her hand from the doorknob. Was there a way to say this without freaking him out? Brill mentioned a potions tent.
She does love potions. Takes after my father. Ancestors watch over him.
Right. She licked her lips. You guys should be careful in that place. There's been a lot of nasty stuff floating around Richmond. All of Virginia, really, and some other states. Ramar's scarlet eyebrows drew together.
Nasty?
Potions. Charms. Black magic. When she swallowed, it stuck in her throat for a second, and she pushed it down with the image of the dead kid in the damn ritual robes. The guy who was making it got taken care of, but a lot of what he made is still out there. Most of it is targeted at kids. The troll's mouth popped open.
Yeah, I don't think you guys have anything to worry about. Your kid's a lot younger than the ones who got caught up in that stuff. Just keep an eye on her. Make sure she's not picking anything up you wouldn't touch yourself. Okay?
Oh, yes, of course. Blinking furiously and blushing deep purple, just like his daughter, Ramar brought a fist up to his chest and held Cheyenne's gaze with a surprising intensity.
Thank you, Fermor. You still do so much for us.
She ignored his refusal to just use her name. I'd do this for everybody, but I've actually met your daughter, and I like you guys. She's a good kid. I don't want to see her get hurt, or you and Yaji. The troll thumped his chest again, closed his eyes, and nodded.
Cheyenne stood there, waiting for him to move again so she wouldn't feel like an ass just leaving him there, standing like that, in the hallway. When he finally opened his eyes, they held a determination she hadn't seen there before.
Forever grateful, Cheyenne.
You're welcome. Then he broke out into a grin and pointed at her.
I look forward to Wednesday. You'll see how impressive it is, what Yaji can do with the leftovers those vendors call fresh Ogul crops.
With a chuckle, Cheyenne opened the door to her apartment and gave him a little wave.
Can't wait. Have a good night. And you.
Ramar bowed and fortunately turned away to hurry down the hall again before Cheyenne proved once again that she didn't really know how to respond. She slipped inside her apartment and closed the door behind her before kicking off her Vans again. Then she leaned against the door and closed her eyes with a sigh. That was harder than I thought, but worth it if it keeps one more kid from dying. After she pulled herself back together, she headed for her desk and the slip of scrap paper on which she'd written Derg's address. She took her phone out of her pocket just long enough to type the address into her GPS, then she grabbed her jacket off the floor and shrugged it on. There's one more asshole who needs to pay.
Chapter 9. She chose to walk from her apartment on the southeast end of the VCU campus. It was more than enough time to get herself all amped up for kicking some orc ass, and the crisp night air of late September helped her focus her energy. A lot harder to find me later if no one sees me get out of my car. East Clay Street was crowded as usual, even on a Sunday night. The bars were full, the music playing so loud she heard 5 different songs at once, and no one paid much attention to the goth chick on a mission stalking through Jackson Ward. Then she found herself on the same route Ember had taken from the bar 2 weeks ago to the skate park. A new swell of rage burned through her when she walked down the street beside the park and caught a glimpse of the skate park at the other end. The city had repaired the shredded chain-link fence she'd ripped apart with her magic after her first round of going full drow berserker in front of everyone. Wonder if they got the blood out yet. Cheyenne walked around the park, heading toward the northwest side tonight instead. Derg's house was close to the park. 10 minutes later, she found herself on Derg's street, just where she was supposed to be. The streetlights were on, casting halos of dim light across the asphalt and the sidewalks around them, dim enough not to put a drow halfling in the spotlight, at least. She pulled out her phone and double-checked where she was on the GPS. The house she wanted was another block down. The halfling headed that way, forcing her drow power down until she was ready to use it. No accidental magic tonight. No failures. When she stopped in front of the house, just beside Derg's, she almost laughed. Not that she'd expected a rotting, crumbling shack like Kor's, but this just looked like every other 2-story family home on the street, except for where the trees had been planted and the length of the grass in each lawn. Derg's house was pale blue, almost green in the glow of the street lamps. With a final glance up and down the street, Cheyenne let her drow magic take over. It bloomed at the base of her spine and traveled up, filling her from head to toe as she made the transformation in a second. Then she stalked down the sidewalk past just one more house and moved quietly up the steps. This is it. Cover your bases. Cheyenne pressed her hand against the pale blue siding beside the front door and closed her eyes. The image of Derg's house shimmered in her mind's eye. The hallway, kitchen, staircase in the back, 3 bedrooms upstairs. And there in the front living room was the glowing green outline of an orcish shape sitting on the damn couch with his feet propped up on a low table. Removing her hand, the halfling forced herself not to punch through the door when she knocked. A loud grunt rose from inside, followed by the lumbering footsteps of a magical who had no idea what was coming for him. The lock turned in the doorknob, then a deadbolt slid aside, and the door opened.
What the?
She slammed her fist against the door, sending it swinging back against the wall with a bang. Purple sparks flared at her fingertips, and she tossed them at Derg's shoulder to make it clear she meant business. The door's frame splintered when she slammed it closed behind her. The orc staggered backward, clutching his fried shoulder, and snarled,
"You."
"Well, at least you recognize me." A black orb of crackling energy churned in the palm of her hand, and she stalked across the hallway toward him. "What about the girl you shot and left for dead? You remember her, too?"
"What are you, nuts?"
Spit flew from Derg's mouth as he stumbled sideways out of the hallway and into the living room.
"This is my fucking house. You can't just walk in and..."
"Hey, you answered the door. Now you're going to answer my questions." Cheyenne launched the energy ball over his shoulder, missing him on purpose. Her magic crashed against the far wall of the living room, taking down a shelf filled with metal knickknacks and books. "I'm going to make this good." Derg ducked anyway and whirled to see the damage before scrambling back into the living room.
"What do you want?"
"I already told you," she spat. "I'm talking about Ember. In the group of halflings you and your low-life friends met at the skate park 2 weeks ago, you shot her and ran away the minute things got bumpy. Do you remember?"
"Yeah, I fucking remember. The goddamn human running around with halflings. Blonde hair. I remember."
He tripped over the edge of the rug beneath his coffee table and managed not to fall on it.
"Why do you care so much about that earthside piece of..."
"She's not a human, Derg. And even if she was, you need to be stopped." The orc's glowing yellow eyes went wide. Then he lunged for the side table next to the couch. His fingers fumbled at the drawer before he pulled out a handgun and leveled it at her. With a roar, Cheyenne launched black tendrils of magic from her fingertips and slapped the gun out of his thick, meaty green hands. It clattered to the floor out of his reach, and Derg stepped back against the couch. "What the hell are you doing with a gun? Trying to make up for shooting magical blanks?" Derg snarled again and summoned a ball of green magic in his hand.
"At least I can hit what I'm aiming for at close range."
"Oh no, I was aiming for your bookshelf." She conjured another black sphere as Derg launched his spell across the living room. The halfling stepped aside, and the green spell slowed midair, sailing across the room inches at a time. She stormed across the living room until she stood right in front of the orc's outstretched hand, his eyes wide above a snarling grimace, and his tongue poking out from between two stained tusks. Batting his arm aside, she pulled her fist back and sent a killer right hook into his beefy jaw. The world sped up again as she dropped out of drow speed. Green fire hurtled through the house. Derg flew backward over the arm of the couch with a bellow. Beneath his cry of pain and surprise, Cheyenne heard the crunch of his shoulder, dislocated by her little nudge at hyperspeed. The orc collected himself enough to scramble back across the couch, his left arm dangling at his side, before he cradled it against his stomach with another roar.
"You weren't even part of it," he growled. "I don't know who you are, and I wasn't gonna try to find out after that night, but now I'm gonna hunt you down like a fucking animal."
Cheyenne grimaced and headed after him as he pushed himself off the couch, spit flying from between his giant tusks. "You just don't have your head on straight, Derg. I beat you to it." With a last-ditch effort to fight her off, the orc raised his other hand and lit the living room with crackling shards of dark orange light. The halfling lashed out with her black tendrils from both hands. Half of them pinned Derg's arms to his sides, making him howl in pain when the tendrils jerked his dislocated shoulder.
the other half whipped across his face before coiling around his thick neck and tightening. It took everything she had not to clench her fist, draw the whips of her magic even tighter, and break his neck. Durg let out a strangled croak, his dark gray tongue darting out from between his huge lips and those nasty-looking tusks. See, from what I hear, you're just another thug running around trying to scare the shit out of innocent magicals who made the trip out here. Rough 'em up for protection money. Isn't that what you called it? The orc's mouth opened and closed, but only choking gurgles came out. Because the ones who want to make a life for themselves, Earthside, are traitors, right? They gave up on Umbaro Ghoul, and you figured you'd follow them out here and make them pay for it. Not too bad if you line your pockets a little or put some halflings in the hospital, huh? His eyes bulged, and he managed to croak out one word.
Stop!
I'm just getting started. She took a step toward him, taking in every bit of his terrified face as her tendrils tightened around his neck. You almost killed her, asshole, but you didn't. Right now would be a really good time to pray to whatever Ogul gods you want that you're half as lucky.
I can't.
The croak that came out of Durg's gaping mouth this time sounded a lot quieter and weaker. Cheyenne stepped toward him and drew back her fist again, ready for another swing. Before she could follow through, the orc crumpled at her feet, jerking her toward him by the black tendrils connecting her other hand to his neck. The halfling stumbled forward with a grunt and released him from her magic. The tendrils withdrew, and she stepped away from the pile of knocked-out orc lying between the coffee table and the couch. A hiss of disappointment escaped her, and she shook out her hand, her fingers aching from the tight fist she'd made and hadn't gotten the chance to use. The clink of the chains knocking against her wrists was the only sound in the living room above the low hum of cops playing on the TV. Shouldn't have squeezed so hard, she muttered, then nudged the orc with the toe of her shoe. Shit. Turning away from Durg, the halfling tried to calm her breathing and decide what she was going to do next. That was too easy, and not enough. She scanned the living room, her drow magic humming through her with every heartbeat. The back of the orc's brown leather couch was covered in woven blankets that looked a lot like what she'd seen being sold at the magical market in Res 38's Q3. Instead of framed pictures on the wall, the guy had hung long, draping tapestries in dark reds and blues and black. When she caught sight of the tapestry on the wall just above the TV, she froze. On a blood-red background, striped with dirty white, was the shape of a bull's head in black. The eyes were red, all the other lines marking the features of the animal's face done in shimmering silver thread. But the shape was unmistakable, even with the three jagged daggers stuck through the center of the bull's head and the slashes at the corners of the tapestry. Looks like somebody else has a problem with whatever the bull represents. At least he didn't put it on a damn chain around his neck. She stepped toward the opposite wall and the tapestry over the TV to get a better look at those daggers. The blades were curved in undulating lines, all the more painful when they were ripped out of whatever poor sucker found one buried in his flesh. Cheyenne leaned closer to be sure it was real blood dried like a smear of dirt on one of the blades. Not just decorative. Huh. Turning around again, she eyed the unconscious Durg and felt a little better when she saw his chest rising and falling slowly. Okay, I kicked his ass. Now I have something even better. Chapter 10. The first thing Durg Brathol saw when he came to were those glowing golden eyes looming over him. He couldn't see the face they belonged to because the hissing, sparkling ball of black and purple magic drowned it out. But he knew.
He coughed and tried to claw his neck with his left hand, but moving it made him grunt in pain, and that made him cough all over again. Cheyenne sat back on the couch and lowered her magic toward the cushion so he could see her face. Have a nice nap?
You're fucking crazy.
Spit flew from his mouth as he hacked and wheezed and drew in raw, gasping breaths.
Why are you still here?
You're alive, aren't you? The orc's eyes widened, and he tried to scramble away from her across the floor. The halfling sent a burst of purple sparks into the floor beside his hand as a warning, and Durg froze. On purpose, okay? Relax.
Yeah, right.
Don't get me wrong, Durg. The thought ran through my head and hung out for a while. I don't like you. Cheyenne snuffed out the black energy sizzling in her palm, and the air went still around them. But I think you might be a lot more useful to me if you're not zipped up in a body bag. Trust me, I know people who do that for a living. They're very good.
Yeah, I have friends too, Drow.
She sucked a breath through her teeth. Not like mine. My friends have a record of putting your friends in cages, which is where you belong right now. I just called the fro my friends. Ignore the semantics.
Then where's my damn cage?
Durg growled. We're not there yet. If you tell me what I want to know, you might be able to stay home a little longer. Nice place, by the way. The halfling took a quick glance around the room. Minus the spell burns.
Fine. I'll tell you whatever you want, as long as you keep those damn whips away from my neck.
We'll see. Tell me about the bull's head.
What the hell do you...
Cheyenne's hand darted toward the other side of the living room. Purple sparks burst from her fingertips and struck all three of the daggers buried in the tapestry and the wall behind it. Her magic crackled along the steel handles and the blades before fizzling out. That bull's head. And don't tell me it's nothing. Nobody uses an Ogul symbol for a dartboard unless there's a lot of bottled-up hostility behind it. The wounded orc stared up at her from the floor, his eyes wide as he caught his breath, and sized up the dark-skinned drow with the wild, bone-white hair, making herself comfortable on his couch.
For someone who doesn't know what it is, you sure use a lot of phrases from back home.
I'm a quick learner. Talk. The orc sneered at her and pushed himself up enough to sit on the floor and snarl at the pain in his dislocated shoulder.
You know how much shit I could bring down on my head just by talking about this?
You're already swimming in shit, Durg.
You couldn't stand up to those assholes, even if you knew who they were. I swore I was done with it when I...
Cheyenne blasted him with another few purple sparks, this time in his good shoulder, just to even it out. Then she pulled up another sphere of black magic and shoved it toward his face. Quit stalling. I'll use this if you don't spit it out already.
Okay, okay. You're crazy.
The orc leaned away from her crackling magic, his yellow eyes wide again as he let out a nervous hiss.
That fell-damned bull is the insignia for the Ogul's head.
The what?
Guardians of the crown. Shit. Will you take that thing out of my face?
The halfling withdrew her hand, but she kept the black energy churning in her palm, just in case. You're gonna have to break it down even further. He glanced up at her and let out a snorting laugh of surprise.
You've been living under a damn rock, Drow? The Royal Guards. That insignia was branded into every shield and weapon and sewn into every patch on their fell damn...
Durg tried to lift his arm and grunted, freshly reminded of his dislocated shoulder. He lifted his other hand to the same shoulder and tapped it again.
They wore it here, took their orders directly from the crown.
Cheyenne frowned. What are a bunch of royal guards doing Earthside?
That's not...
The orc rolled his eyes.
That was me dumbing it down for you, Drow. They're not guards. Not these days, but their loyalty to the crowns made them even crazier than they were when the Rhys needed real guards. Now they're just screwed up henchmen. Again, dumbing it down.
When the halfling moved her sphere of black energy slowly closer to his face, Durg hissed. So what are they doing, Earthside?
Spreading the crown's fucking crusade. They've been trying to bring the same shit to this world that's been rotting the heart of Umbaro Ghoul for centuries.
What does that mean?
Exactly what I said.
Durg licked his spit-covered lips and glanced quickly from her to her threatening black spell and back.
I came over here to get away from all that just like everyone else. Don't bring me into it.
I'm not gonna get anything else out of this scumbag. Snuffing out her black orb one more time, Cheyenne leaned away from him and pressed her hands into her thighs. No, I won't bring you into it, but I'll be watching you from here on out, Durg Brithol. I know you made your crossing in March, that you came off Res 7, that you apparently didn't start making trouble until you thought all eyes were finally off you and focused somewhere else. The orc just stared at her, breathing heavily. She pushed to her feet and loomed over him. If I want any more information out of you, you'd be even more of an idiot not to give it to me when I ask, because I know where you live now, too. Durg just growled at her as she turned away from him, fully intending to step right back through his front door and leave him there to deal with the mess. Then the doorknob turned with a squeak, and the front door swung open. Before the halfling could turn around and ask if the asshole was expecting friends tonight, a girl stepped through the door. She couldn't have been older than 17 and was dressed in all black with more than one ring on each of her fingers. Half of her head was shaved, the hair on the other half falling just below her chin. And if Cheyenne didn't know better, she would have said she was staring at a 15-year-old version of herself. The girl closed the door behind her, her pale face with too much makeup lit up by the glow of her cell phone screen. Uncle Durg, I'm home. She shoved her phone into the back pocket of her skin-tight black leather pants, then pulled a ring off her thumb. The air shimmered around her, and the goth teenager standing in the front hallway was now a green-skinned orc teenager, and the goth part was extra. Uncle Durg? Cheyenne cocked her head when the girl finally looked into the living room, pocketing the ring as well. The young orc froze, taking in the smashed bookshelf, her rattled uncle on the floor, and the scowling drow standing in her living room.
What's going on?
Hey!
The halfling smiled and spread her arms. Your uncle and I were just having a little chat, trying to clear up a misunderstanding from a couple of weeks ago. Durg huffed behind her, but didn't argue. Cheyenne turned again and pointed at him.
You better start behaving, my friend. No more shakedowns. Got it?
He glared at her, his yellow eyes burning.
Trust me, Durg. I'll know if you try to slide anything by without me noticing. See you soon.
With that, the drow halfling stalked across the living room and raised her eyebrows at the goth orc, who was shooting back the same deadpan stare. The girl stepped aside to give Cheyenne plenty of room to get to the door. Cheyenne swept her gaze over the teenager and nodded.
Looks good on you.
Uh-huh.
The halfling's gaze landed on the massive metal skull painted black and silver. It dangled at the end of a black satin ribbon tied around the orc's neck.
Nice skull. Nice jacket.
Cheyenne jerked her chin at the girl, then opened the door and stepped back out into the crisp September night. The door closed behind her as she reached the bottom of the stairs leading up to the porch. She couldn't help but smirk as she headed back down the dark street with an extra bounce in her step. Everything comes with a price. Bianca Summerlin had drilled it into her daughter from the very beginning, and the saying kept popping up in Cheyenne's mind.
Guess the price this time was an epic fight with revenge at the end. Worth it. She hadn't expected to feel this good about letting Durg off as easily as she had. Maybe that was part of what Bianca had meant. Even revenge had a price, and if she'd paid it, she never would have figured out what those damn bull's head pendants meant.
Chapter 11.
Cheyenne checked her phone as she walked down the hall toward her apartment. Only 10:30. Productive night. She pulled her key ring from the pocket of her black canvas jacket and stuck the key in the lock. When she opened the door, she almost leaped back out into the hall again. The copper drow puzzle box had freed itself from her backpack and lay right on the carpet in front of her. Not where I left you. She shut the door quickly, then nudged the box across the floor with her foot. It rolled a little on its edges and came to a stop beside her backpack again. Corian wants me to haul this thing back across town, not with a bunch of Ogulish loyalists hunting me. Rolling her eyes, she kicked off her black Vans and headed back into the hall. Raising both arms high above her head, she gave a massive yawn and shuffled into her bedroom. Like a night stalker knows anything about drow legacies. The halfling scratched her right shoulder and stopped. With a snort, she pulled the shirt away from her shoulder and ripped off the gauze bandage she'd been wearing all day like an idiot. The gauze and extra tape fluttered to the floor, and she stripped down and climbed into bed with her cell phone, set her alarm, and stuck it on the bedside table. She took one more look at her shoulder, rubbing the smooth-heeled skin with a smile. Best thing that drow bastard ever did for me. Probably won't be able to top it. Pushing aside her thoughts of L'zar Verdys, Cheyenne climbed under the sheets and her comforter with the giant skull sprawling across the center and snuggled down. Finally, a good night's sleep. She yawned again and buried her head in the pillow. Another crazy dream filled her head that night, and Cheyenne knew from the beginning it was just a dream. That didn't make it any less vivid or any less terrifying. She was walking down a cold, dark corridor of black stone. This wasn't anything like the damp walls of the dungeon at Chateau D'rahl. The stone had been cut and laid with skill and was worn by time. The hallway seemed to stretch on forever until she was suddenly at the end of it, looking into a huge circular room of the same black stone with high vaulted ceilings. It was even colder. Blood splattered the black walls everywhere she looked. Every few feet, long, thin, frayed banners spilled down the walls toward the floor. They fluttered in the freezing draft kicking up from all directions. Then the halfling noticed the floor. It was littered with bodies of all different sizes, strewn in the positions they'd been standing in when they'd been struck down. She didn't recognize the clothing. Loose, flowing things, frayed like the banners and soaked with blood, only the blood on their clothes glistened in the light of the torches blazing around the room. Everybody lying on the floor had the dark, purple-gray skin and the bone-white hair of the drow. In the center of the bodies knelt a huddled shape draped in black robes. Another drow, judging by the stark white hair falling around the bowed head and the dark ears poking through. When the drow lifted his head and met her gaze, Cheyenne's throat tightened. L'zar. His golden eyes glowed in the darkness, far brighter than the torches sending shadows flicking across the black stone. But the careless half-smile was gone, replaced by a creased brow and a grimace of anguish that didn't look right on her father's face. L'zar stared at her through the curtain of his white hair, a silent cry not yet released from his open mouth. "I thought I could stop it." His voice echoed around the huge stone room, the torches flickering with each resounding word. "But I wasn't strong enough. Now, it's your turn." Cheyenne jolted out of sleep with a gasp, only to scramble across her bed until her back thumped against the wall. The copper puzzle box hovered near her, emitting rays of golden light, The thing clicked and whirled, each piece of the spastic Rubik's Cube spinning wildly in front of her. The halfling reacted without thinking. Heat bloomed at the base of her spine, and her now purple-gray hand reached out to snatch the box out of the air. "Leave me alone!" An orb of black energy flared to life in her other hand, and she clamped it around the puzzle box that was vibrating madly in her palm. The golden light filling her bedroom was muted by a flash of black and purple between her hands, then the legacy box fell still. Breathing heavily, Cheyenne snarled and dropped the box onto the bed. It rolled a little, stopped, and then one row of those shifting runes etched into the metal slowly turned. The thing let out a soft click, and the outer layer of symbols that had turned flashed one last dim light. What the hell? The halfling pulled her gaze away from the copper box to stare at her drow dark hands. Did my magic just turn that thing? Her eyes widened, and she lunged across the bed to grab the box and try again. She did everything the same, black spheres of her magic with purple sparks bursting into her hands before she smothered the box again with the spell. There was a dull thump, and purple sparks flew through her fingers across the room, but that was it. Fine. Cheyenne tossed the box back onto her comforter. We both have a limit. Then she grabbed her phone off the bedside table just as her alarm went off. She snorted. Right on time. Once she'd showered, blow-dried her now black hair, and donned her whole outfit of black on black on black, putting a little more black around her eyes, Cheyenne headed out to the living room. She stopped in the doorway to her bedroom, feeling another little prickle at the back of her neck, and scowled over her shoulder at the drow puzzle box resting on her bed. Don't move. The shower had woken her up, but she still yawned when she stooped beside the kitchen's half wall to snatch up her backpack and sling it over her shoulder. More crazy dreams. No wonder L'zar got locked up. The image of her drow father kneeling in the center of those drow bodies was pretty hard to shake out of her head. Might have some truth to it. Like the Rog Oracle said, everyone who touched that box is dead. Not this halfling. She slipped into her Vans and hesitated before grabbing the doorknob, but nothing from her dream flashed out at her this time, and she was only too happy to get the hell out of her apartment and away from the box. Before she closed the door, she paused to take another sweeping glance across her apartment, then shook her head. Forget it. Cheyenne sat through her classes and one more time fought not to rip her hair out and claw her eyes with boredom. Just like every Monday. Just like every day of the week. Apparently, showing up on time to every class spared her from the snide remarks and dubious glances from her professors, and the first conversation she had with anyone wasn't until after her last class as she walked across the quad toward the computer sciences building. She shot a skeptical glance at the student message board and the bench halfway across the lawn where a group of other college students was gathered to check out the new flyers posted there. A guy in a button-down shirt with a messenger bag slung over his shoulder and brown hair hanging over his eyes caught her looking and thought she was interested. "Hey!" He headed toward her, even as she sped up. "We're looking for more people to join the chess club. You interested?" The halfling glanced at the flyer he waved at her and stopped. Squinting at him, she gestured toward her black clothes and the silver zippers and safety pins studding her shirt, then spread her arms. "Really?" The guy tossed his shaggy hair out of his eyes and gave her a crooked smile. "Hey, don't judge a book by its cover, right?" "Probably a good idea with this book." Cheyenne took off down the sidewalk again, and Mr. Chess Club laughed behind her. "Okay, the flyers are up if you change your mind. Have a great day." This was a normal college. She should have stuck with online classes between chasing down magical scum.
She reached the computer sciences building without any more interruptions and found Maddie Bergman's office door wide open, as usual. With a quick knock, Cheyenne stepped into her professor's office and shrugged. Happy Monday? Maddie looked up from the work on her desk and chuckled. You're saying one thing, but your face says the complete opposite. Good to know I'm an open book. The halfling cocked her head. Second time I've been compared to a book today. Well, get ready for one more. A book, I mean. Actually, the professor said, chuckling, not so much a book as a giant stack of papers. I made copies. I hope you weren't expecting anything fancy. The woman pulled open the bottom drawer of her desk and withdrew a huge stack of paper, thumping it down on the edge of her desk. Just like I promised. Whoa. Slipping her backpack off, Cheyenne stepped toward the desk and eyed the words printed on the top sheet. Cheyenne S., huh? Way to keep it top secret. You know what? That's the only way I'd remember what the hell I'm supposed to do with a monster stack like this. Otherwise, I'd have a heart attack thinking it was a bunch of papers I forgot to grade, and I'd probably end up throwing it in the trash. Maddie looked up at her student and smirked. It's better than collection of spells and healing magic. Fair enough. The halfling slid the papers off the desk and cradled them in one arm while she quickly flipped through. These were spells, all right, most of them labeled in a language she didn't know, but they all had drawings of hands doing different things with different fingers. You brought this across with you from the other side? Maddie chuckled and shook her head. Definitely not. Trust me, the books over here are a lot harder to read, and even more impossible to pin down without someone holding your hand every step of the way. Maybe literally. I simplified it. Oh, yeah, this looks real simple. Cheyenne sighed and shook her head. You could have pulled out a whole bunch and then tied all this together with a piece of string at least. Please, Cheyenne, you can write me into a box with your programming skills, and you expect me to believe you don't know how to keep a bunch of loose paper together? Ignoring the jab, the halfling set the stack on the desk again and flipped through it again for a better look. Seriously, how is this simplified? All these drawings and diagrams, plus what, like 100 spells? More. And the recipes for all those healing salves and whatever are in the back. With a laugh, Cheyenne looked at the copied pages, just now registering how they'd gotten on the paper. Did you write all this yourself? And the drawings? I sure did, halfling. Took me damn near a year to get down even that much, and that's just the beginner's guide. Maddie sat back in her office chair and tucked her wavy black hair behind her ear. That's why you get copies only. How much more is there? The advanced stuff? Oh, 3 or 4 times as much. The woman laughed when Cheyenne looked at her with wide eyes. I'll say this much, kid. I had a lot of time on my hands when I first came over. And in some weird, naive burst of inspiration, I thought it would be a good idea to get all this down. Thought I'd find myself some kind of apprentice and make a living that way. Worked out pretty well, huh? You know enough about computer programming to make a living this way, too. Cheyenne picked her backpack up off the floor and propped it on her knee before unzipping the main pocket. I can't believe you crossed the border with a bunch of training with magic books just so you could rewrite them. What? That would have been crazy, Maddie said with raised eyebrows. She looked more than a little overwhelmed at the thought. I never would have made it if I'd done that. I copied it all down from up here. When Cheyenne looked up again, she found the woman tapping her temple with a knowing smile. Huh. Remind me never to try getting into your head. That's not something you can do, is it? The anxiety in the question made the halfling pause.
No mind reading on that list of surprise magic you mentioned.
Not that I know of.
That's a thing?
Right. Good. You know me. Just had to ask.
Maddie shrugged and tried to laugh it off, but the fact that she'd asked hung between them.
Well, if that ever shows up, I'll make sure to tell you before I use it on you.
The professor almost choked and brought a fist to her mouth to clear her throat.
I wouldn't expect anything like that, Cheyenne. There were a very small number of magicals who could work their way into someone else's head before I came here, and I don't think they've been working on cultivating that particular skill since I left.
Why not?
Let's just say it's a lot harder than it sounds, for both parties.
The halfling nodded, staring at the Night Stalker under her human disguise. Then she grabbed the stack of spells again and shoved it into her backpack as neatly as she could.
Stay away from mind reading. Got it.
She felt Professor Bergman's gaze wandering all over her, even before the woman opened her mouth.
Cheyenne.
Maddie squinted when the halfling looked at her.
Something's different about you. It could be anything from the last 24 hours.
Like what?
I don't know.
The woman tipped her head back and frowned.
Just different. What did you get into over the weekend?
Cheyenne smirked. We both know you don't want me to answer that.
No.
You're right. Keeping my mouth shut. Maddie mimed zipping her lips and nodded.
Whatever it is, it looks good on you, halfling.
Thanks, I guess. The tense silence of ending a conversation they never started returned. Then Maddie clapped and plastered on a polite grin.
Well, I guess you're on your own now, learning those spells. That should be enough to get you started, but come back if you have any questions.
I always do, even when she won't answer half of them. The halfling slung her backpack over her shoulder again, but paused before heading across the office.
Actually, I have some questions right now, if you still have time for your one and only drow halfling in training.
Sitting back in her chair, Maddie folded her arms.
You know it depends on the questions.
Yeah, I know. But they are just about magic, I promise.
Then fire away, not literally.
With a playful roll of her eyes, Cheyenne readjusted the strap of her backpack and shifted her weight to the other hip.
Based on what little you know about drow in general, and drow halflings specifically, how much do drow magic and night stalker magic have in common?
Maddie's lips opened in surprise, and she blinked.
In regards to those spells I gave you? They're accessible to everyone.
No, I meant inherent abilities. You know, like my purple sparks or something stronger.
Oh, yeah, the cute ones.
Cheyenne snorted.
Very funny.
I mean, if you knew more about all the abilities I have, which may or may not still be on the surprise magic list, would you say they're like what you can do?
Huh. Well, your magic isn't like what an orc or a troll can dish out. Maybe even a fairy.
A fairy? Maddie shook her head and gave a dismissive wave.
If there are any of them left, probably not. But I honestly don't know enough about drow magic to be able to say it's much like anything but drow magic.
Very helpful. The halfling took a deep breath. Can you move super fast or aim lightning bolts across the ground? Her professor raised an eyebrow and eyed her sideways.
What gave you that idea?
Just pulling it out of my head. This is all hypothetical.
Uh-huh.
The woman chewed the inside of her bottom lip for a second, still frowning at her student.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.